Now the moment the supernatural family has all been waiting for. Let's welcome Jensen Jared and Jared Padalecki.
She loves to laugh, she loves to sing, she does everything. She loves to move, she loves to groove.
Oh, Jared, you look so handsome.
I know. And you look, man.
I look alive.
You pretty much. I mean,
not saying a lot.
50-50. Yeah. Hi, guys, gals.
This is going to be strange for all involved here because Jared and I cannot see you. And we've never done a panel where we could not see you. So unfortunately, we don't get to receive that energy and it's gonna be a little different, but you're basically just gonna sit here and watch the two of us talk like idiots.
Luckily, we've been for 15 years acting with like tape X's on the walls for visual effects of demons and tennis balls standing on poles for different stunts and visual effects.
Or when you're asked to leave the set because you can't keep it together. People can't work when you're there.
Yeah, that too, but who's counting? I don't remember. It's way too far back in the day. Yeah. Excited to be here with you guys, from afar. Jensen and I both are almost 7 days into our 14-day quarantine. Got shipped up here.
No, this is day seven.
Well, tonight is day seven.
We're in day seven.
Is that true?
It's not true.
We're in day six, man.
We're in day six.
Yeah. I think we're still, I know. I think the pumpkin time is like 7 p.m. I think we started at 7 p.m. on Sunday, August 2nd. And so we have to go to 7 p.m. Sunday, August 16th, right? Does that make sense? I don't know.
Next Sunday, I'm going to go outside.
Just lay outside.
Sunday night.
If y'all fly to Vancouver, just look for two hairy dudes that look like guys from Sam and Dean.
Yeah, just like running out into the surf for no reason.
Frolicking. I'm going to have balloons and a parachute.
Jared, what have you been doing during your 6 days of quarantine? I know because we've been sharing our stories together, but for those that don't, what have you been doing?
Well, I'm glad you asked, Jensen. I have lived in the same apartment here in Vancouver for about 6 years. So I have built a life here somewhat. You know, we've had three kids here. We didn't have them here, but three kids lived here while we were shooting, Jen and I. And so I've just got stuff everywhere. That's why my frame is so small, because if I were to move my computer this way or that way, it's just tubs, stacked up tubs of like kids' toys and coffee mugs and books and magazines and everything else. So I've been using this time to gradually grow through my apartment and try and figure out what to do with myself. It's kind of been torturous. I've got a nice little patio that I can see what's going on outside, but it's so beautiful here. And as Jensen knows, it's like 100 degrees with 100% humidity in Texas. So you don't want to go outside. But here I'm looking outside like if I could only. So I wish it was kind of – this is when I wish it was like October or November, December, where it's rainy and gray. And I'm like, I ain't going outside. So I've been sitting here. Just cleaning up. What about you, Mr. Ackles? What have you been up to?
Just kind of straightening up the place. I've been in this place for 6 years now. So this particular apartment. So knowing that the end is nigh, I've started to go through. It's amazing how much crap you can collect. In just, you know, even, and this really, like, to be fair, we don't live here. This is really just kind of like a crash pad, you know. It's our home when we're working, but for the most part, it's not where we keep, you know, all of our valuables and all of our, you know,
our kids,
our memories. But still, there's just a lot of crap. Yeah. So I've been kind of slowly going through everything. and trying not to slowly go insane.
More watching, not to go more insane.
More insane. Well, here's I found a tool to help with that kind of that lonely feeling. There's a show called Alone. I'm serious, man.
I know.
You sit here, you're watching these people like sleep on like rocks and tree shrubs, and they're eating slugs and they're trying to catch fish. Meanwhile, I've like just had a pizza ordered and delivered, and I've like a beer, and I'm like, okay, maybe being by myself in this place isn't so bad after all.
Yeah, but at least you're outside.
Yeah, yeah.
No, yeah. That's a good show. Tom and Shepard watching that. That's funny. Yeah. I heard that there's a Joe Rogan podcast with the winner, so I don't want to give it up. But I heard the Joe Rogan podcast with the winner a month or two ago or something like
that. Well, there's like six seasons. There's like six different. Okay.
I guess the most recent season. I haven't Not seen it. Any of it, admittedly. I just heard about it via podcast. But yeah. Tom and Shepard apparently like, oh, and he got a moose, and then the bear stole it, and they're bugs. And they love, Tom and Shep love, like, chasing lizards and everything right. else that can happen outside. So yeah. All right. Seems like we've both been spending our time well.
Yeah. Yeah. That's great.
Yeah.
Should we take some questions?
Let's do it.
Cause we know what we're doing, but
you don't have to.
Probably. Okay. I'll ask the first one. This one is from, Stacy Klobnak. Listen, we're going to butcher some names. And by we, I mean Jared. But just, you know,
my own name. Paddle. Jared P.
Over the past seasons, you have worked with great actors. Who would you like to work with again?
You want me to go first?
Yeah, sure. Go.
All right. You know, we've obviously worked with a lot of actors that have been on the show several times, and they've also been part of this family, this virtual family right now, you know, since we're doing it from afar. So the list goes on with some of the people we've been around. Some of the actors and actresses that I feel I've worked with that I would love to work with again and hopefully get to work with again. And also, frankly, in Supernatural, we've been able to work with them again. You know, I think we've all died. We have people who died 12 years ago that are still back on the show now. I'm going to say one name. It's the first name that came to my head because I do get to work with him again, and that's the esteemed gentleman and scholar Mitch Pileggi. So if this world kind of calms back down a little bit, then he and I get to work together again back down in Austin, Texas. So I'm excited about that. But I've also been excited about some of the actors and actresses who were kind of on their way up. You know, I when COVID started, I talked to Sterling K. Brown a few times just via text, just kind of shoot back and forth, like what's going on in y'all's world. And so we've been around for 15 years. And so some of the actors and actresses that we worked with way back in the day now have their own shows, or in Sterling's case, their own show and 1,000 Emmys.
And a mantle of awards.
Get a brand new house for his mantle of awards.
Right.
That's always kind of fun because Jensen and I have had so many people come on set, and we've had some people who have done a ton of work, and we kind of look at each other and we're like, all right, they're solid. And then we've had some people come on and it's their first show or their second show, and we look at each other after rehearsal like, damn, like this girl or this guy can bring it. And so the list goes on and on. Ackles?
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to pick one. There's a, you know, over the course of 15 years, we've had a lot of really talented people come through the door. And like Jared said, you know, some have gone on to have great success. I mean, look at Jeffrey Dean Morgan, look at Sterling, yeah. look at Catherine Newton, there's a reason that these actors have brought such great life to Supernatural, and it's because they're just really, really talented, and we were lucky to have them. And I'm happy that other people notice that talent and that they are continuing to have success. Again, hard to pick one. Chris Heyerdahl, I think is one of my favorite arcs. Who else? I mean, it was always fun working with Fred Lane. You know, I don't know. There's so many. We always have a good time working with the ladies, you know, with Kim and with Brianna and with Catherine. And so it's always fun having them around. That's a hard question to pick one. I would say we've got at least a dozen that I could think of right now. That's just, please come back. And who knows? Maybe they will.
Maybe they will. All right. I will do the next question. Okay. You did Stace Klobnak. I'm going to do Nancy LM921. First off, I really wonder what LM921 stands for. It's like the planet I come from is, I'm going to stop. all right. Which castmate was the most surprising to meet, or who was the most memorable first meeting? I mean, I feel like I got a pretty easy one here, so I'll start. Sometime around season 4, episode 1, I think it was July 9th, 2008, I met this little guest starlet. She's pretty cute, and she was in her underwear. And I think I remember saying to myself, I'm going to marry that girl. So I did. I think when I met Jen, my wife, so I don't know if surprising, it was certainly a memorable first meeting. I guess I'm surprised in hindsight to have met her on the show at a weird time, you know, in season 4, and she and I have talked about it, and she's like, it was really intimidating. Like, I was coming in and there are these like two big old Texan dudes, and everybody knew each other and y'all were all friends. And then I was like this little girl in her underwear, like, hi, nice to meet you. I'm here to play the girl in her underwear in a hotel room. But here we are 12 years later, Jesus. So I think that was pretty poignant.
You know, I just realized that every time Dean catches Sam with a girl, she's wearing the same thing.
It's in my contract.
Seriously, because when in episode, Jessica was in panties and a little tight shirt.
It's in my contract.
And then Jen, literally, panties and a little tight shirt.
I have a type.
Yeah, apparently your type is women who hate wearing pants.
Isn't that all of our type?
It's so limiting. I just want to be free in my underwear.
Hey, I don't write it. I just acted.
No, you just make requests, and that's fair. I don't blame you. So memorable characters. Yes, I would say one that was. This is going to be weird. We've had a lot of very memorable characters come in and out. I'd say one that was kind of. I was anticipating and not quite sure how it was going to go was when Paris Hilton came on the show.
Oh yeah.
And I remember, cause you know, she was kind of at the height of her
fame,
whatever it was, and had a very, you know, established, reputation, let's say. And so I think everybody had an idea of like who she was and what she was like. And as did I. So when she came on set, I was very shocked to see that was not actually her persona, that she was like a pro and she was cool. And she wasn't this kind of like bubbly, bumbling personality that she put on for the masses, which that's when I was like, smart.
Yeah.
Smart. Okay. All right. I see you.
And by the way, in the same vein, Nicole, when she came on, as the world knows as Snooki, you know,
right.
I watched Jersey Shore and I was like, man, Jim Tan Laundry, that's a good motto to live life by. And so you have this idea of who someone's going to be. And then she came on set. She had just had a kid. And we didn't know what to expect, right? But it was like, okay, maybe she's going to come up and have a posse or whatever. And she came up like with her mom to help her kid and her kid. And she knew her lines, she hit her marks, and she was just super professional and kind. And I was like, good on her, you know, like, that's tough to be. It's tough when the world, and this was pre, you know, social media getting so big that anything you say or do just gets lambasted and blown up. And so to have her come on set and just be professional and kind and sweet, was really cool. I feel like it's nice for me to be humbled and be proven wrong. You know, it's like, man, don't judge a book by its cover. Like I said, I teach it like I know it. And then I fall into that trap sometimes, and I love being proven wrong.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Next. If you could give advice. Oh, this is from, oh, wait, is that
Lauren 2926?
No, Nancy LM921.
Weird. I read.
Is this a two-parter?
No, I read Nancy LM921, but then my eyes went to Lauren 2926. So
I'll read Nancy LM921 here. Question for J2.
That prior question was Lauren 2926.
Right.
Now we're doing Nancy's question, though. Sorry, first time, guys. I didn't get a rehearsal. I'm so nervous.
If you could give advice to your younger selves beginning acting, what would it be?
Wow. Don't quarantine. Just kidding. I'll try and start it out. I guess I've had some time to think about this. To go off on a little bit of a tangent. These last 4.5 months, and Ackles and I talked about it, traveling up here and over the last couple of days, we got into such a routine with Supernatural. You know, there was the longest we ever went without filming was either the writer's strike back in 2007, 2008 or between seasons, but it was like less than 3 months is the longest that we've ever gone without playing Sam and Dean Winchester. And so you have a lot of time to reflect. And also you're at home because there's a pandemic. And so you're not going out. So you're kind of stuck in your head with your thoughts. And think about what does it all mean? You know, I've been in this business for 20 years and Ackles has been in this business for like 52 years, I think it was. 56 years. I mix up twos and sixes. Right. My bad. But you have time to kind of think about what it means. And I mean, my first thought was, wow, one pandemic and there's no more need for a talking monkey. I was like, my world is useless. My vocation has no meaning. So I was acting to myself at my home in Austin. It was pretty embarrassing. Beyond that, I realized, you know, you get caught up to some degree, and he and I both live in Texas and we film in Vancouver, British Columbia. And so we've had wonderful opportunities to travel, to embody new characters and to explore new ideas and new thematics and new stories. And it's really intoxicating. It's so fun. And it comes with very obvious perks. You know, we can pay our bills and, you know, we can buy a nice dinner if we want. But I guess I realized when we were quarantined for 4.5 months, just how much I missed the work. Like I really do love stories. I love hearing stories. I love when someone's a savvy raconteur and can hold court with a group of people they never met, telling anecdotes or stories or jokes or whatever. I'm an absolute audience member. Like I love being there. And I'm like, oh, they're going to tell another story. I love those friends that I have. But I guess I realized that the through line for me in acting was I loved acting long before I ever got paid to act. And if I didn't, I think the lows, because there are a lot of downsides to this business, as wonderful as it is, but the lows of being away from family, being away from friends, being in an apartment for 2 weeks, to, you know, away from your kids that you've just been with for 4 months, or your wife or your husband or whatever, your home, the downs are pretty real. And so if you don't have a really true, deep underlying love of the work of what you're doing, then I don't think it'll last. And so make sure if you choose to go forward with acting, make sure there's nothing else you can do. You know, if it's like, well, I'd like to act, but I do love teaching. I like to act, but I do love engineering. I'd like to act, but I do love science, or I love making coffee or whatever. Then acting's a difficult route. But if you wake up and you go like, man, I strive and desire to go tell a story, to go embody a character, to go explore another mindset through somebody else's writing that has a whole different set of experiences and knowledge, then I think it might be for you. Apples.
I would say advice-wise, and this was some advice that I did get early on, which I was grateful for, and I guess I would give a very similar piece of advice in that when starting out with acting, you have to, first you have to get in the room, and you have to audition for people, and they're going to be sometimes brutally honest. So you have to develop a thick skin very quickly. But I would say that the biggest thing that helped me was, if acting was like fishing, you don't want to just drop one line in the water. You want to cast a wide net. It's a game of numbers. The more you audition, the more you learn, and the more you, have an opportunity of hitting. So, you know, there were roles that I really, really wanted and that I really thought I was going to get and I didn't get. And I was very discouraged of that. So I quickly learned that when I go in for that audition or I go in for that meeting or I go in for that callback, just treat that as my last performance. Boom. Walk out the door. What's next? They call you back. Hey, it's an encore. If you get the job, fantastic. Now you got something to focus on. But you keep trying, keep trying, keep trying, keep trying. You know, somebody said, you know, you get knocked down 7 times, you get up 8.
All right. SPN Suite. Hi, J2. I think that's a Brazilian flag. Amazing. I hope there are some Brazilians out there. My question is, if you could change anything about your characters, what would it be? Love you. Love you back. I'll start. If I could change anything about my character. I think if you had asked me this question, we knew the fundamentals of playing tennis, but we didn't know if the person across the net from us was going to hit a forehand or a backhand, if they were going to lob it or if they were going to jam it down. And so you just kind of learn who you are, learn the fundamentals, and you go with the flow. And so I feel like I have a good sense of who Sam was and who Sam has been and who he's becoming. And I'm really excited to do our last 16 days of filming. And I can hear a groan. Even though no one's here, I can hear people going like, ah, maybe that's just me. Maybe that's my mindset going, ah. But I feel like I'm ready to go with the flow.
Adel. Something I'd change about the character, probably his diet. because at this point, Dean is more likely to die from heart disease than a vampire. So,
fair enough.
Yeah, there we go.
True story.
All right. Hunter Life SPN. Hello, my name is Vittoria.
Vittoria.
Did you imagine at the beginning of the series that it would have this proportion that is today with 15 seasons? No. No, not at all. That's why everybody we meet in the industry is like, God, I can't believe that show is still going.
And we're like, it's still going?
Or that show's still on? Yeah, obviously nobody could have predicted that this show would have lasted this long. I think early predictions were that the show could really go for a successful run of like 3 to 5 seasons. And that is a very successful run of any show. So the fact that we went three times that is that's it's unheard of, and it certainly was not predicted by any means. But I think that because of the world that that Eric had created, it just lent itself to a continuous exploration of it. And luckily, we had some very brilliant people manning the helm of taking the story on to new levels and to greater lengths. And so it's been quite a ride. We certainly don't ever know where we're going, but we, you know, they, like they say, life is about the journey, not the destination. And we have certainly been on a long and beautiful journey for 15 years that we never, never expected. So,
I agree with Aggles. We were hoping to get a back nine pickup, which in TV speak is, you know, when you do your pilot, you get picked up, you usually get 13 episode order. So you get basically the first half of season one plus a few episodes. And we were like, man, I think we got something. Like, I think we might go a full season. Remember, we had a guy who worked on the show the first couple of years, and he would always be like, yeah, y'all going 10 years, buy a house. And it was like, he was one of these folksy guys, kind of old school, the Teamster. And every time we'd be like, he's like, mark my words, you're going 10 years. And we're like, well, I hope so, but you know, like, don't cash the check. And it turns out he was wrong, but not wrong in the way that.
Yeah. Little did he know. 15, pal.
We were right about him being wrong.
That's right.
So we were the fools, I suppose. No, it's been, and frankly, and this is obviously on camera, so maybe I shouldn't say this. I feel like the show could go 15 more, honestly. Like, I feel like we have so much that we could do, so many stories we could tell. But I feel like we're going to deliver episode 327 and all the ones before it with some gusto and with 100% dedication. And then we'll see from there. But this certainly went further than I would have ever dreamt.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, Dragon Embers. What prop do you want to take from the set when it's over? Jensen?
Prop.
Yeah, prop. Wheels.
What's that? Not wheels.
Props don't have wheels.
Props don't have wheels. You know what I'd really like, but they're not gonna part with that for a lot of reasons. But the Colt.
Oh.
I think that would be super cool because it was built for the show. And it just has, you know, I think it was such an important piece of the show, and it's just cool. And it also still has some of my blood on it from when I had the showdown in Frontierland.
No shit.
When I had to do this, the boom.
Yeah, oh yeah, flag it.
Yeah, that hammer was so hard to pull back that it just literally ripped my palm open. So I think that I think I should just own it for that sake, that I've bled on it.
Well,
I don't know. There's what?
If Elon Musk keeps going the way he's going, then we will be able to clone you based on the Colt. So maybe that should go to like a museum, Smithsonian.
Perfect. All right. I'm okay with that. I'm okay
thousands
with that.
Of Ackles. Ackles's? Ackley?
Ackley.
Pluralize your name. Ackley.
Yeah.
Ackley everywhere.
Yeah, I don't know. I could think of a ton, but that's certainly one that I would like that I probably won't get. What about you?
So many. And there may have been a few little bits here and there that nobody would ever miss or even know they were part of the show.
That have gotten misplaced.
Yeah, they get lost, you know, things move and between seasons. That mean a lot to me, though. If somebody walked in my house, they wouldn't know anything about it. But if I were to take one of the kind of integral props from the show, I got to go with the demon knife. I got to go with the demon knife for several reasons.
Demon blades, good choice.
Demon blades, good choice. And, you know, I think when the conversation happens with Tom and Shep and Odette about, like, why did Uncle Jensen kill Mom? I can be like, well, I'm not sure, but here's the weapon. Here's from the crime scene itself.
Right.
Also, when I do something, when I make some mistake, which I do often, and Jen gets mad at me, I can just hold it as self-defense and be like, this has killed you once before. Don't make me call Jensen. So I think the demon knife would be the demon blade would be pretty awesome. And I don't know if everybody knows this out there, but when it was created, you know, they created the hilt of the blade that you hold and then the blade itself, but it was put on inverted. So actually when you hold the knife,
you're holding it upside down.
Holding it upside down. But since it made it to camera that way, it had to stay that way for the entire run of the show. So it's kind of a neat little, you know, I love the little asterisks or the little, I think it's the mistakes that make something perfect. And so I think it's a neat little
happy accident.
Happy accident.
Yeah. All right. Emma Shane. I'm currently in high school right now. And you started the show the year I was born. Do you think you were more of a Sam or Dean in school?
I mean, I was certainly more of a Sam.
Yeah, I was probably a healthy blend of the two. You know, Dean, I feel like Dean would have gotten a little bit, he would have been more resistant of authority and rule following. I try to keep it in the you know, keep it in between the lines. For the most part, I probably had and hung around with a group of friends that liked to toe the line a little bit more than I. So I was tempted to do things that probably, you know, Sam wouldn't do. But yeah, I'd say as far as the mischievous aspect of it, I was probably a happy blend of both.
Yeah, I was Sam through and through. I loved academics. I loved school. I was a math guy, and still am. Still love doing weird math puzzles and riddles and whatnot. So, and I don't think I was anywhere near as brave as Dean is. You know, I wasn't as tough as Sam, but I certainly, I still do love school. One of these days I'd like to go take some more. But Emma, kick ass, senior year might be a little strange. Our hearts and thoughts go out to you and all the other seniors out there. But I think I'd go with Sam. Okay, Louisa Fernandez. Louisa_Fernandez. Hey boys. Hey, which is your favorite line of the show and why? Brazil loves you. Love Brazil.
Favorite line of the show. Whew, there's been so many. Do you have one offhand?
I mean, I lost my shoe. Makes me laugh.
That's so stupid.
And I remember filming it, by the way. I remember vividly filming that scene in that alley where I was like, and they had to go clean. So there's a bit of, I don't know how to say this other than there's a bit of drug use in Vancouver. And so they send people the day before to clean it and like bleach the entire alley and get rid of needles and other kind of drug paraphernalia. And then they send somebody the day of as well. And so they're like, well, don't wear your shoes into your trailer after you go from set, like take your shoes off before you go into your trailer. So you're not tracking whatever there is there. Don't grab anything off the ground. You know, don't touch your face. This is pre-pandemic. Don't touch your face. And I remember I had to keep on, and I remember the shoe had a little metal. So the bottom of those Puma shoes, they had soldered or put in a little metal bit and then created the grate in such a way where as I'm getting the gum off the bottom of my shoe, I had to, Jared had to catch the little metal hook onto the broken grate that was a prop to get my shoe off. And I remember I had a tough time with it at first. It was kind of in a weird part of the shoe and the arch or something. But I remember filming it vividly. I lost my shoe. What kind of low sodium freaks don't have salt? I do love me some salt. So that stuck out. There have been so many. Yeah, those
family don't end in blood.
Family don't end in blood.
Driver picks music.
Shotgun. Yep.
I'm trying to think of like some really like emotional ones, and I really do like it was kind of Dean's death scene after he got the crap beat out of him by Metatron, but when Dean says, "I'm proud of us."
Dude, I was gonna say that exact. I'm not a word of a lie.
Yeah, because I feel like that line is something that could be used almost every season from one brother to another brother. You know, just like looking at what they've done, looking at what they've accomplished, or looking at what they've survived, and they could both easily very, you know, look at each other and just be like, "I'm proud of us." I think that's a big underline quote of the show.
I agree totally. Yep. And I think it's also even more so, I feel like it's something that Sam strive to be able to say, which is one of the reasons they work so hard, so diligently, they sacrifice so much. They want to be able to say, "I'm proud of us." So that honesty, I'm choking up, the honesty and the vulnerability of admitting like, "Hey, if this is it, man, I'm proud of us."
Yeah.
Is pretty deep. And I swear my life, I was about to say the same thing.
It's good. It's a good one. All right. Moving on to Ana Cristina Fagunde. I'm probably butchering that.
Tu Brute.
What do you miss most from the first season? First seasons?
Yeah, first couple seasons.
What do you miss most from the first seasons?
You know, I miss you. You know.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I could certainly take a stab. I would say that in the first couple of seasons, it was simpler times. The structure of the show and the world that the boys found themselves in, and the motivation behind what they were doing was simpler. You know, they were hunters of things that go bump in the dark, and their father has gone missing, and they've got to find their dad. And I think that's such a simple concept, with such a giant road in front of them, that I miss that kind of like setting out on a very clear cut objective and journey, and not knowing exactly what lays in store, but having that kind of clear motivation, I think is something that we continued to have throughout the years. But I think it just, as the world expanded, it became more complicated. And as characters came on and it expanded then to like heaven and hell, and there were demons and the angels, and then it was God. And like, so it got really, really big and very, a very complicated world that these guys then had to, you know, navigate. I think in the beginning it was just simpler, and I enjoyed that.
Yeah. I enjoyed that as well. I'm going to kind of go on the same coin, but maybe the flip side of the coin. What I loved, or what I remember, you know, the halcyon days of the first couple seasons, it almost felt, in hindsight at least, it felt like falling in love. It's like, there's something here. There's some sort of magic. I don't know what it is. I don't know what it's going to look like, but there's something here. It almost felt like the honeymoon phase or something. It was like, we were trying this, we were trying that.
No, this just got awkward. Am I blushing?
I'm lonely. Just kidding. No one's here. It's just me and my dog.
We knew it.
Send pictures and videos. I missed that feeling where you know something is going to be special. You know something's going to be big. You don't know yet what form that special and big is going to take. And it's kind of, we talked about this in other instances and other mediums, kind of just keep on working until you figure out what you're working for, you know, with always keep fighting. It's like, keep on fighting. Even if you don't know what you're fighting for, just keep fighting. It'll materialize. You know, you'll have something tangible. And with those first couple seasons of the show, we all knew there was a buzz. There was a feeling. It was visceral, but it was almost like a connection we felt to our crew, to the city, to the characters, to the story. And it was like, there's something, man, this could be something. And so as that foundation built of just excitement and the willingness to sacrifice and work hard, and that passion, watching it materialize and being a part of it materializing. And with y'all, you know, I mean, we started doing conventions season 2 or 3. But like, this is something, man. Like this is something. This could be something that's really fun for a couple of years, not knowing that, you know, it's gonna be a part of our lives for the rest of our lives till we breathe our last. So there was a really neat little, like, I don't know, startup. Thank you, Anna Cristina Fagunde. How'd you say it? Fagunde. Crystal Christenberg. The brothers have been
to Christenberg.
I don't know what that accent was.
I'm sorry, Crystal.
Yeah, Christenberg. Lo siento. Crystal Christenberg. The brothers have been to a few famously haunted locations. Is there one you guys would have loved to have the brothers, or one that you guys would love to have the brothers investigate?
Yes.
Yeah.
Amityville.
Oh.
We never been there, right?
I never have, no.
No, but I mean, the Winchesters have never, we never.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Also.
The dog walkers here.
That's okay, because I would love for the brothers to go to the Winchester Mystery House. I went with Jen and Tom when he was maybe a year or two old. He was a little thing, and got a tour, and just the idea that it's part of. I've never been to Lawrence, Kansas. So Jared wants to go to Lawrence, and Jared will go to Lawrence. And Jared will stop speaking in the third person right now. I would love for the brothers to go to the Winchester Mystery House. That would be too cool. I don't know how to say it, but spin-off? What would we call it? Wouldn't we call it
a spin-off? This is like another episode.
Another episode?
Special features?
Special features.
Warner Home Video. Get on it.
Warner Home, Netflix.
Yeah.
My phone's on. It's on vibrate right now, so I don't interrupt. But
all right.
Hello.
Luana Lolo. Right? Luana Lolo? Say that 3 times real fast.
I can't. I can't even say it once.
Nailed it. If you could have a conversation with Sam and Dean, what would you say to them? Brazil loves you guys. Well,
don't leave the bunker.
Don't leave the bunker. Yeah.
Stay there. It's cool.
Like, take a vacation. Take a vacation. There's other hunters out there.
Yeah.
We're trying to quit trying to carry the load. Like just, you know, take it easy for a second. You don't have to always go.
Come on, stop.
You know?
You have an angel friend. Make him do it.
Yeah. Sit back. Smell the motor oil.
I mean, smell the nuclear bunker. Yeah, I mean, they're friends with a Nephilim and an angel. Like, put them to work.
Yeah.
Relaxing.
Sit on the beach.
Come on, guys. Have a beer. Get some sun.
Have yourself a drink with too much fruit in it, you know? Do yourself a favor.
Put some bacon in that drink.
Wait, did we ever do an episode? I know we did that one where we went to like that like health spa thing, but did we ever? Was there ever like a moment where like the guys had to do like spa stuff? I don't think so.
Just the health spa episode with the fat sucker.
Yeah.
Where we all met Donna Hanscom, Brianna. I know we had an episode right when whatever year the ice bucket challenge was going on. Remember we had a scene, I think it was the first episode, where Sam and Dean are sitting on like folding chairs looking out over that lake on the way to Whistler, Squamish. And the little green, the green cooler.
Oh, that's a good prop.
Yeah. But the green cooler between the two boys, because I think we turned it into the ice bucket challenge afterwards. So
yeah.
That's, I think, the most relaxation we've seen Sam and Dean in 327 episodes.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what I would say to Sam and Dean.
Yeah.
Have more moments like that.
Yeah. Here's a good thing. Speaking of, I mean, we have the Amityville extra episode special features. We have the Winchester Mystery House extra episode special features. If y'all are willing to watch an hour, it'd be an hour because, you know, it might be streaming or something. But if Sam and Dean Winchester getting a massage, I think that'd be a great episode. I'm just saying, write your local congressman or woman, send copious amounts.
Start a petition.
Start a petition.
Yep.
We'll sign it. It's just literally an hour long of Sam and Dean, not Jared and Jensen. It's not about us. It's about Sam and Dean getting a massage. You write it, I'll act it.
I mean, there's some comedy in there, you know? They bring out the hot rocks.
The octopus suction things.
What do they call those? The cups or whatever?
Cupping, yeah.
Cupping, yeah. Yeah, I can see Dean really enjoying that. All right. your turn.
Jowdy. J-O-U-D-Y. Jowdy?
Jody?
Jowdy.
Jody? Judy. Jowdy.
Jowdy! What was the hardest skill you had to learn for the show? Love from Syria. Hi.
Sweet. Hi,
love you. Love you back.
Wow.
Hi, Syria. The hardest skill we had to learn for the show. This is going to sound weird. Fight scenes. Because of this, because when you fight or hit something, you're fighting or hitting something. Whereas for fight scenes, you have to train yourself to like punch 3 inches away from something or look like you're tackling somebody, but then pull at the last second. It's almost like trying to look like you're throwing the football as hard as you can, but make it go 3 feet. It's like, okay, well, don't I just throw it as hard as I can? Like, no, the camera's not. If you punch too fast, the camera's not going to. So really, you know, you're not supposed to punch like this. And then you're supposed to just go straight to it. So it takes some focus to go like, okay, remember, you want to look like you're punching a bad guy, but you want to not punch the bad guy. So it's this really weird juxtaposition of like, sorry, my dog wants to get petted. He sees me fighting the air.
I feel like, you know, when we first, started the show, Jared and I had like, I don't know, we did like 6 weeks of like rigorous boxing training just to kind of get ourselves in shape. And like, you know, they wanted to make sure we knew how to throw a punch, which I don't know why they think we didn't. But we did, and it's, you know, when you're actually boxing training, you're hitting something. You're hitting a heavy bag. You're hitting focus mitts. You're hitting each other when we got in the ring with some headgear on. Cut to like a couple episodes in, and Jared and I actually get into a bar fight in Vancouver. That's well documented. It was not our fault. But we were able to protect ourselves, let's say, very well. Yeah. And against with being way outnumbered, but we still, because we just come off all this intense training, and you know, we I think grown up in a life of athletics, so we were able to handle ourselves.
Yeah.
Now, after 15 years of stunt training, if somebody were to jump Jared and I in a bar, we would not land one punch. It would be like,
though. It would look good on camera.
But it would look so good if somebody was filming it. The only problem is the people that we were fighting would be like,
yeah, what are they doing?
Why are you swinging and missing me by a half a foot? So like,
this guy has bad vision. I'm going to leave him alone.
So to all you out, so people out there, if you see us, please don't pick a fight with us because it's going to be embarrassing for all of us.
Yeah.
Okay. The hardest skill I think I had to learn was the knife throwing was difficult, but that was fun. I actually enjoyed that. Oh, I know. Phil Segrecia wanted me to do this thing in I forget what episode it was, but where it was a motel room scene and Dean is sitting there cleaning all the weapons, cleaning the guns. And I had Dean's 45, his side-by-side shotgun, and I think it was your 9 as well, your Beretta, Sam's Beretta. And he wanted me to have them, to take them all apart, clean them, and then put them all back together again without looking at them while saying the dialogue. And that was, that proved to be difficult.
It's also like, hey, I have a great idea for the scene tomorrow morning.
Yeah. Could you practice this for like the next 20 minutes and then we can put it on camera?
Yeah.
I'd say it's a toss up between learning to do all of that it together without looking, you know, taking it apart, cleaning it, putting it back together without looking and saying dialogue, that or tap dancing.
Yeah. You and DJ. That's what I was going to say. Yeah. That looked pretty intense.
That was intense is one word for it.
Yeah. Awesome. Thank you, Jody.
All right. João Victor.
Joe.
What do you think Sam and Dean would be doing in this quarantine?
I think Sam would be reading, eating salad, and running on the treadmill, kind of like Jared. Mm-hmm. So I feel like Sam would be organizing the library, probably reading a lot of lore books, sharpening his mental acuity, and probably trying to be healthy, maybe running around the bunker, doing what he can do.
I think Dean would be on his way to full-blown diabetes and probably under the hood of the car.
Yeah, in the garage, yeah.
Yeah, just a plate of bacon and like brake fluid and grease.
Yeah, fair enough. Bia Faria. If you could have any real life power from any supernatural character, what would it be and why? Brazil loves you. Obrigado.
Obrigado.
I know what I would want.
What?
This would be a double-edged sword because I would want to be able to do it, but then I would probably regret it shortly thereafter.
No. What are you going to say?
Shapeshift.
You know what I mean? I thought you were going to say read people's minds.
Oh, no. That I don't want to be able to do that.
I don't want to know. Like, I don't want to know.
Shapeshifting is like a mid-ground because if you kind of want to know what somebody thinks, if you could shapeshift into like a confidant or a friend, you could kind of get a little insight without getting the brutal truth. I certainly wouldn't want anybody to be able to read my mind. They would just be confused and probably pass out.
Fly. I would in a heartbeat. Fly.
Like Michael and Lucifer?
No. Like Superman.
No, from Supernatural.
Oh, is that what it is then?
Yeah. I mean, Michael.
Any real life power from any supernatural character? Oh, I thought for some reason I was thinking superhero. Supernatural character. Okay, then time jump.
Ooh.
I'd want to be able to like go forward in time or backward in time.
Yeah. Would you go forward in time? I don't know if I would.
Yeah. To see like where we're headed.
That'd be so scary. And maybe. Then backward in time, it'd be the whole butterfly effect thing. I read some funny.
Funny, don't touch anything.
I read some funny, like, you know, I don't know, Instagram meme or something like that about like 2020 must be the year where somebody in the future has figured out how to go back in time, because there have been so many things that keep on going wrong and then vanishing, like the murder hornets. Like the murder hornets were going to kill everybody, you know, and then because somebody went back to like 1970 and swatted a fly or something. And they morphed, and then all of a sudden they're gone.
Did you see the owl that flew into the patrol car and the cop crashed? Yeah, it was like a giant barred owl.
What?
And there's like a picture of it in the front seat. And who was it? I think it was Patton Oswalt. He wrote, "Oh great, now they've activated the owls." Oh no, it was Andy Richter. It was Andy Richter tweeted. He was like, "Oh great, now they've activated the owls."
Yeah, but I think going forward and backwards might be like a little bit of a hi to Coda, everybody.
So hi, buddy.
Coda.
He won't leave me alone. Yeah, this must be like the butterfly effect year. Time jumping would be a lot of fun.
We get the Starbucks that I go to back home. I just go in and grab a coffee, but they've always got question of the days. Like what the question of the day is. And it's, you know, it's like, would you jump out of a plane? Would you
parachute, or like, are you allowed to,
or it's like, what's your favorite time of year? Like what's your favorite season? One of them was, if you could travel to any decade, what would it be?
Ooh.
Yeah. I said a future decade.
Really?
Yeah.
What do you want? You want Neuralink or you want flying cars?
Oh, we should definitely have flying cars by now. This is ridiculous. Come on, Elon.
We all want to the future. Come on, Michael J. Fox.
Yeah, come on.
We saw you with the skateboard.
Yeah, where's my hoverboard? It's 2020. I want my hoverboard.
I don't know, man. I would think probably 60s.
Yeah, you know what's funny is it kind of called into, and maybe this is just because of the climate of our society right now, but it called into like where we were as a country, kind of on a social aspect. Awesome. And it's like, and that's why I was like, sure, there'd be a lot of decades I'd like to go back to, but I certainly know that things weren't right back then.
Yeah.
So I think that's why I said future, because hopefully we're doing it better than we've done it.
Or there's just nothing. We all have guilt.
It's just a barren wasteland, and it's like, oh, okay, let me go back to the present future and start selling everything I have.
This is where everybody who's logged into the Zoom is like, this is depressing.
Wow, these guys are on lockdown for 7 days.
I'm crying now, yeah. Thanks for the question.
All right,
next. Okay. Anishka Rao. Is that Brazilian? How? Anishka Rao. What's your most memorable moment from Supernatural? Lots of love from India, Jared and Jensen. Lots of love back. So cool that people from all over the world are coming to visit. I don't feel so lonely anymore.
India, right on. Most memorable moment. Yeah. That's hard. That's like asking what your most memorable moment of the last 15 years of your life has been. There have been quite a few.
Yeah.
Very, very memorable moments.
I think if I were to try and think about five, because a few come up. I remember shooting the last scene of the pilot. We got work to do, closing the trunk. I remember, and this didn't happen on camera, but I remember Phil Segrisha, bringing him back up again, during the filming of the 200th episode, he had all the actresses who were playing Sam and Dean and Bobby Singer perform Carry On, My Wayward Son for the cast and crew. So we just sat in the auditorium at this high school here in Vancouver and they performed it. I remember being so, like, chills everywhere. Like, I didn't know I had pores on my shoulder, but everything was just like goosebumps. And that was pretty emotional. And again, back in season 10, we didn't know that we'd go much beyond 200. We hoped, but you know, you never know. So there have been little, more than a specific moment, there have been kind of like pit stops along the way. Obviously season 4 with Jen, and season 6 was it with like Frenchman. I remember there have been certain times where I've almost felt like I'm on the outside looking in, I know filming that video with Misha announcing that 15 would be our 15th and final was memorable. You know, it was sad, and I felt very sad and very proud at the same time. I remember that scene with Curtis as Metatron and Jensen as Dean. I'm proud of us, because that was another one of those moments where I was like, man, if this all ended, if the show doesn't get picked back up, I am proud of us. And so it seems like all of these moments, like the We Got Work to Do in the pilot, or, you know, seeing Carry On performed by a bunch of talented young actors for our 200th episode, or acknowledging that we're about to be, you know, 15 and final, have been moments where I was like, you know, I don't allow myself to be proud of myself very often. I always feel like I have work to do. So maybe that's a combination of realizing I got work to do, and Jensen and I sitting here in our apartments, we got work to do. 7 days of quarantine work before we get to do the fun work. But also I am proud of us. So I think it's been a conglomeration of those moments, I suppose.
There was a moment that happened last year, and it wasn't on the show, but it was certainly Supernatural related. And that was that I'll never forget. And that was the last time we took the stage at Comic-Con.
Oh God.
Walking out and seeing that crowd and knowing that that was going to be the last time for this show was very, very heavy. It was a weighty moment, and it was a moment that I'll never forget, just from a finality standpoint, and also just from a look at what we have all had a hand in creating. That was a pretty special moment. I don't think we hit it well.
no, we did not. That was a difficult one. Yeah, the Comic-Con moments. Yeah, good point. You know, the and the last one.
Well, on that lovely, uplifting moment, I think that actually concludes our first ever virtual. See, look at this, 15 years in, and we're still having firsts.
It's ridiculous.
It is ridiculous.
Ridiculous. COVID can't stop Supernatural in the fandom.
That's right. COVID can't kill this fandom. Not even a try. That's it. They're telling us to wrap it up. One last question. Nope, that's it. That's the last question. Stop talking, Jared. Stop talking. Okay.
That's now, just you writing that.
Now they're just yelling at us. So that's okay.
Wish we could see y'all's faces, but we can feel your presence. That's for sure. Welcome. And hi from around the world. I'm trying to do the math in my head of what time it must be in Syria or India. I think Brazil, you're in your evening right now. So thank you all for joining from everywhere. We feel the love. And right now it's there are only two hearts beating inside of my apartment. And one is my furry four-legger. So it is a little lonesome, but I feel nice and warm knowing you guys are out there. So thank you all.
Yeah, thanks for tuning in. Thanks for the questions. Thanks for sticking with us. We hope you had a little entertainment during this crazy wacky time that we're all in. But yeah. Stay safe. We miss y'all. Can't wait to see your smiling faces without a mask on soon.
Yeah.
Jensen, Jared, on behalf of the entire Supernatural family, we're sending you lots of love, hugs, and well wishes as you embark on the last two episodes of this incredible show we've all come to love, and spending your last 15 years with us. Okay.